Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpender Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have the 18th of February 2021 and we are going to start with our current affairs. So these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. These examinations require you to answer the few questions related to the daily current affairs. So you can refer our channel on the YouTube. You can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, and you can get the daily current affairs on the day-to-day basis. Okay, so today we have the 18th of February 2021. So let's have the class for the 18th of February. Okay, so first is basically the Comprehensive Economic Cooperation and Partnership Agreement, that is called CECPA. Okay, so that Comprehensive Economic Cooperation and the Partnership Agreement was basically signed between India and the Mauritius. Okay, so that, you know, that CECPA basically approved by the Union Cabinet. Okay, so once it is approved, okay, that will be, you know, that will be, you know, ultimately executed between the India and the Mauritius. Okay, so that will be a Comprehensive Economic Cooperation Agreement. That means that will include, right, the trade, right, that will include some sort of a, you know, the trade related barriers, right, the sanitary and, you know, phytosanitary measures, that will also have certain sort of the resolution related to the disputes. Okay, that will also involve, you know, other issues like finance, transport, telecom, right, and the cooperation in other areas. So it is a very comprehensive agreement which is approved by the Union Cabinet, right, between India and the Mauritius. Let's understand some of the salient features of the agreement between India and the Mauritius. Okay, so it is a first trade agreement. It will be the first trade agreement that is basically signed, right, between India and the Mauritius. Okay, this agreement has very comprehensively covered, right, various aspects of the cooperation between India and the Mauritius. Okay, and that will have the most comprehensive agreement between the two countries. Okay, so the agreement basically covers the trade in the goods. Okay, the issues related to trades in the goods, that is rule of origin related to the trading of the goods, then trade in the services. Then this agreement also try to remove the technical barriers which is there with respect to the trade. Okay, some sort of restrictions with respect to the trade, right, like sanitary and phytosanitary barriers, right. It will take certain measures so that the trade related aspect can be enhanced, right. Then dispute settlement procedure mechanism between the two countries will be undertaken. Okay, the movement of the natural persons between the two countries will also be undertaken under this agreement. Then issues related to the telecom sector, the issues related to the financial services, okay, custom related procedure will also be streamlined, and there will be a cooperation in other areas. So this is the most comprehensive economic agreement between the two countries, right? And it is the first such agreement that was signed by the India with a country in Africa. Okay, the CECPA basically provide the institutional mechanism. That means certain set of institutions will be set up that will be taken care, right, the all comprehensive measures that will be taken under CECPA between India and Mauritius. So it will basically boost the institutional mechanism to encourage the trade between the two countries, India and the Mauritius. Okay, and you know, both the countries, India and the Mauritius, also agreed to negotiate an automatic trigger safeguard mechanism. Okay, that automatic trigger safeguard mechanism would basically safeguard, right, the important aspects of the trade related, you know, issues, as well as it will also safeguard, you know, the important aspects of the related, you know, aspects of the trade. For example, the India's concerns as well as the Mauritius concern will be automatically taken care of there, taken care of that, and that will be safeguarding the most, you know, pressing issues between the two countries, right. It will also prioritize the issues based on the two, you know, based on this Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, and that will have, you know, the limited number of slightly sensitive projects within the 2 years of signing of agreement. All right. So this is basically Indian Ocean where the Mauritius is located. Okay, bail. So it is basically something which is related to, you know, the Geeta Thunberg case, the Greta Thunberg, basically, you know, the case where, you know, the Shantanu Shivlal Muluk, right, is going to be arrested by the Delhi police. So the Shantanu Shivlal Muluk, basically, who is also a follower of the Greta Thunberg. The Greta Thunberg toolkit was basically shared by the Shantanu Shivlal Muluk. And right, the Delhi police have registered an FIR related to that toolkit, which was related to the farmers' protests, which were agitating against the three central laws in Delhi. So in that toolkit, when the Shantanu Shivlal Muluk has shared that toolkit, the Delhi High Court has already registered an FIR. And in that case, already one arrest has already done. And it will be the second arrest under this Greta Thunberg Kulmus case. So the Shantanu has approached the Bombay High Court for the basically anticipatory bail in this case. So Bombay High Court basically granted the transit anticipatory bail, okay, to the Shantanu in this case. Okay, so here is the transit anticipatory bail is something which is, you know, for example, the Shantanu is staying in the Maharashtra, and Delhi police has registered an FIR. Okay, so Delhi police will go to the Maharashtra and arrest that Shantanu and will bring the Shantanu to the Delhi. Okay, but what is happening here is that Delhi, is before even arriving the Delhi police, the Shantanu has moved to the Bombay High Court for protection. And that protection was granted to the Shantanu for not arresting the Shantanu by the Delhi police. So that is called basically the transit anticipatory bail. Okay, according to Article 22, okay, that is, you know, related to your fundamental rights, the Constitution also provide certain safeguards, right? The protection, you know, in respect of arrest and the detention, right? So no person can be detained or arrested, right, without even, you know, right, and 24 hours the person should be produced before the magistrate, right? So that 24 hours should exclude, I mean, it should generally exclude the travel time from the person who is basically arrested at that place to reaching to the magistrate, okay? But definitely once arrested, within 24 hours of the arrest, the person should be brought before the magistrate, and magistrate will check out the legality of the detention, which was arrested by the police. Okay, if the magistrate found that the legality of the detention is lawful, okay, then the magistrate basically, you know, generally sends the accused to the judicial custody. If the magistrate found that the legality of the detention is not warranted, not needed, then the magistrate ordered immediately the police to leave the person. Okay, so under Article 22, there can be two types of detention. First of all, one is called punitive detention, another is called basically preventive detention. Okay, the person who is arrested because of some filing of an FIR, right, can be produced or should be produced before the magistrate within 24 hours of the arrest. Okay, now under this Article 22 also says that no person can be arrested or no person can be kept in the custody beyond 24 hours. So that means it is the time which is fixed that within 24 hours the person should be produced before the magistrate. Okay, but this section 56 of the CRPC states that, right, the person who has been arrested, right, should be immediately produced to the magistrate without unnecessary delay. Okay, that unnecessary delay because of any reasons, right, but that does not include the traveling time of the police, right, for reaching the person to the nearest magistrate. Okay, and when the person basically apply the anticipatory transit bail, as I told you that the anticipatory transit bail is basically applied by any person, right, to the competent court, right, when the person is basically apprehending the arrest by the police. Okay, so if another state police is basically going to arrest the person, right, he can basically approach to the judiciary in his own state itself, right, if the court has the power to grant the protection from the arrest. And such type of, you know, protection is generally in the form of transit anticipatory bail or pre-arrest bail. So such type of bail has been already granted by the Bombay High Court to the Shantanu, right, who is basically apprehending the arrest from the Delhi police, especially in the Greta Thunberg toolkit case. All right. So she is basically Greta Thunberg. Okay. Next, the National Hydrogen Mission. Okay. Now you must understand that transportation is one sector of the economy. The transportation basically causes almost one third of the greenhouse gas emissions. Okay, so greenhouse gases are basically those gases which are causing the climatic changes, okay, which are increasing the temperature of the environment, Okay, these greenhouse gases are maybe carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, methane, right? These are few greenhouse gases. The transportation sector, right, correspond to or account for almost 1/3 of the greenhouse gases to the environment. Okay, now to reduce that greenhouse gases, the India announced the National Hydrogen Mission. Okay, under this National Hydrogen Mission, the proposal was brought under the budget also. Okay, and a draft over the next couple of months would be prepared for the National Hydrogen Mission. Okay, now the hydrogen as a fuel, okay, can have the potential of transforming the transportation also. Obviously, the end use sectors, including steel and the chemicals, can also be used the hydrogen as a basically different type of resources for their industrial development. Okay, and in October 2020 itself, the Delhi first time used, right, the hydrogen blended compressed natural gas, that is called the hydrogen spiked compressed natural gas, right? It was the Delhi become the first city to operate the buses on HCNG, that is hydrogen blended compressed natural gas. This project was the, you know, a pilot project which runs for 6 months just to check the efficacy of the hydrogen blended compressed natural gas. The ultimate aim of, you know, promoting the hydrogen as a fuel is to reduce the emission of the greenhouse gases, ultimately to control or regulate the climatic changes that is occurring because of the greenhouse gas emissions. Okay, then this technology of blending, you know, the hydrogen into the CNG, okay, this is the new technology, right, based on which the buses can ply on the roads. This technology has patented by the Indian Oil Corporation Limited, which is a PSU under Government of India. Okay, so this technology has already been patented for the production of the HCNG. Okay, and that is basically include the 18% of hydrogen in the CNG. So you can say that 18% of the hydrogen is comparatively a cleaner fuel, okay, which is also renewable, right? Natural gas is, you know, comparatively lesser, you know, impacting, but definitely the CNG is basically also causing some sort of a, you know, climatic changes also. But hydrogen is comparatively cleaner. Okay, so which resort to the, you know, conventional without resorting to the conventional blending. Okay, so Indian Oil Corporation, which is basically patented this technology of production of HCNG, the Indian Oil Corporation is also planning to set up a dedicated unit. This dedicated unit would produce the hydrogen, okay, that will be ultimately used with the CNG to produce HCNG, okay, and that will be used to run the buses, right, especially in the Delhi, okay, so that the Delhi's, you know, pollution can be somewhat controlled. Okay, the IOC is planning to set up this dedicated unit for the production of hydrogen in its R&D center in Faridabad, Haryana. Okay, regarding the supportive framework also provided by the Government of India, here the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways, okay, issued, you know, the supporting notification, right, regarding the regulatory framework of production of this hydrogen blended the CNG gas, right? So the notification proposing the amendment to the Central Motor Vehicles Rules 1989, okay, and that rules basically is going to be amended, which include the safety evaluation standard for the hydrogen fuel cell based vehicles. Okay, so that will allow or that will regulate the safety related, you know, standards for the hydrogen filled vehicles that can ply on the roads in the Delhi itself. Okay, next, the production linked incentive, that is PLI, production linked incentive scheme for the telecom and the networking products. Okay, so now the Government of India is basically, as you know, that started the Make in India program. Okay, under the Make in India, the government is mainly emphasizing on the indigenous production of certain, you know, sectors, right, which are basically the India is dependent on the imports. For example, the telecom related, you know, the products or the networking related products, okay, the India is heavily dependent on the China or some of the Korean countries and Japan also. Okay, so India is basically importing the telecom and the networking products from the Japan, Korea and the China, right? So the Union Cabinet has approved a production linked incentive, right, scheme that will be basically, you know, incentivize the producers who produce the telecom products as well as the networking products, okay, so that it can cut down the imports of those products from the China and, you know, neighboring countries, right? And that will basically, you know, also benefit the India in terms of Make in India also. So this year, the budgetary outlay for this is basically 12,195 crore, right? For the production linked incentive scheme for the production of telecom and networking products. Okay. Now, as I told you, this scheme, the production linked incentive scheme, is intent to promote the manufacture of telecom and the networking products. Okay. So that will be basically promoting the telecom and the networking products in India. Okay. The government is trying to give the financial incentives to the producers. Okay. That will basically definitely boost the domestic manufacturing of those telecom and the networking products. And simultaneously, right, you know, apart from the boosting of the production capacity, right, or indigenous production capacity, the India also will attract the investment in this sector also. Okay. So the target sectors are telecom and the networking, where the India will get its own investment apart from the domestic manufacturing capacity, right, in order to encourage the Make in India as a real, you know, goal. Okay. Now, the scheme will also encourage the exports of telecom and the networking products under the Make in India, Made in India program. So obviously, if that manufacturing capacity is boosted, then the investment have been, you know, put in, the India can export also the telecom and networking products also. Okay. Now, under this scheme, okay, the companies are basically engaging in the manufacturing of the specified telecom and networking products in India. And these companies are basically eligible to get the financial incentives. Okay. So that incentives will be provided to those companies if they meet certain minimum threshold of, you know, requirement or certain minimum threshold. Right. So the production linked incentivized scheme is basically encouraging that type of companies who is already in the fray and who has the who have you know, achieved the minimum threshold level for the production of these telecom and networking products. Okay. So here the eligibility is basically subjected to the achievement of minimum threshold of the cumulative increment investment over the period of 4 years. Okay. So those companies who have, you know, the cumulative increment investment over the period of 4 years and, right, the incremental sales of the manufacturing goods net of the taxes, right, over the base of year 2019 and 20 will be based on those companies. And there is also the minimum investment threshold. For example, the minimum investment threshold for those micro, small and the medium enterprises, that is called MSME. The minimum investment threshold is 10 crore rupees for MSME, right? For that, the incentives will be given from 7% to 4%. Okay. And for other companies who are not MSMEs, the minimum investment threshold is 100 crore rupees. Okay. And for them, the incentives will be given from 6% to 4% over 5 years above the base year. Okay. And those applicants or those industries which are beyond or which are having the higher investment plans, okay, which are, you know, not specified in a particular threshold, for example, in our single line, if that type of industries or that type of investment comes, okay, right, under either MSME or non-MSME categories, right, will be selected through, you know, through a transparent process, and that will be undertaken, right, as, you know, that will be selected on the case-to-case basis. So that will be selected by the government of India on the case-to-case basis. Okay. Next, juvenile justice. So all you know that Juvenile Justice Care and the Protection Act of the Children Act 2015 was passed by the parliament, right, to take the measures to protection of child-related issues, right, or to protect the children from any sort of abuse. So here, the Ministry of the Women and the Child Development basically have proposed certain changes in the Juvenile Justice Care and the Protection of the Children Act 2015. Okay. The Union Cabinet has approved the proposals given by the Ministry of Women and the Child Development, right, to amend the Juvenile Justice Care and the Protection Act 2015. Okay. So Union Cabinet has approved that proposal, and that these proposals will ultimately strengthen the child protection setup or the mechanism to protection of the child, right, especially, right, from various issues. It will be a best interest to the children under this amendment done. Okay. Now, the amendments basically includes the authorizing district magistrate, okay? The district magistrate or additional district magistrate, both can issue, okay? The adoption orders, for example, if the person want to adopt a children, right? So the amendment basically authorized or empowered the district magistrate or additional district magistrate to issue the adoption orders under Section 61 of Juvenile Justice Care and Protection Act of the Children's 2015. So under 61 JVJ Act 2015, right, the district magistrate and additional district magistrate are authorized to issue the adoption orders, and that will basically, you know, ensure the speedy disposal of the cases related to the adoption related matters of the juveniles. Okay, then the district magistrate also empowered, right, under this act, JJ Act 2015, to ensure the smooth implementation of JJ Act. Okay, and that will basically synergize the efforts put right under this act. That will be the best favor in the favor of the children, especially those children who are already in the distress. Okay, regarding eligibility parameters, the amendment has certain changes. Okay, so certain changes, for example, you know, previously undefined offenses now also incorporated in the Amendment Act and the Amendment Bill of JJ Act, right, which will be incorporated as a serious offense. So the previously undefined offenses now will be categorized as serious offenses, so that it can better protect the children from any sort of abuse. Okay, and there were previously various difficulties faced by the implementation of the various provisions. Now these difficulties have now been removed, addressed. Now the various provisions of the act can be easily implemented in the court of the law. Okay, next, the water treatment plant at the Eru Vikara, right, at the Eru Vikara basically is a municipality in Kerala. So here you must understand that the Prime Minister would inaugurate the 75 million liters per day a water treatment plant at the Eru Vikara in the Kerala. So here, this treatment plant, right, which was basically set up under, you know, the center's grant, and that will basically treat per day 75 million liters of the wastewater, right? It is basically built under the Amrit Mission, which is Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation. Amrit means Atal Mission for Rejuvenation and Urban Transformation, which was basically launched in 2015 by the Government of India. So this water treatment plant in Kerala was built under the Amrit Mission. Okay, this water treatment plant will basically boost the supply of drinking water to the people of Thiruvananthapuram. Okay, and that will basically also address the issues related to the water shortage, right? The disruption of the, you know, the drinking water supply to the city, right? As well as this will also, help in, you know, alleviation of the water shortage, especially in the, you know, existing treatment plants in the Eru Vikara. Okay, the Atal Mission for the Rejuvenation and the Urban Transformation basically, you know, a mission which was launched by the Government of India in 2015, right? This mission aims of providing the basic civic amenities, especially to the urban areas. Okay, now these basic civic amenities may be related to the water supply, sewerage, the urban transport, parks, etc. Right, so obviously when you provide these type of civic amenities to the people, right, that will definitely improve the quality of the life of the people, okay, especially the poor and the marginalized sections of the society, and that may also help in alleviation of the poverty in the urban areas also. Okay, so it is basically a water treatment plant that will basically treat 75 million liters of the water per day, and that will help in alleviation of the water shortage in the Thiruvananthapuram and basically in the Eru Vikara area. Okay, then smart road projects. Okay, so this is the most advanced project that will be laid foundation by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation for the construction of the smart road project in the Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Okay, so what is the smart road project? Smart road project means you will have certain better amenities, right, utilities all along the road. So you will have the better alignments of the road, you will have better improvement, better pedestrian movement, right, better regulations on the road, right, you will try to minimize the accidents on the road, so you will have all sort of a structural and you know all sort of a measure so that it can contain the accidents on the road. So that is something which is related to the smart road project. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation stone for the smart road projects in the Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. So this project will be undertaken at the estimate cost of 427 crore. Okay, and that project will basically emphasize converting of already built 37 kilometers of the existing roads in the Thiruvananthapuram to the world class smart roads. Okay, so that will be, you know, a renovation or converting of 37 kilometers of existing roads into the smart roads. Okay, that will be providing certain, you know, the improvement in the roads as well as in the junctions as well as the pedestrian movements all along the roads. Okay, so it will have certain features like, right, for example, the pedestrian footpath, it will be there. Safe pathways will be there so that the pedestrian can move all along the pathways. Okay, you will have the junction improvement so that it can basically control any sort of accidents all along the junctions. Okay, normally what happens is all along the roads you will have the drain water which is basically, you know, flooded in the on the roads, and that may cause, you know, sometime, you know, situations like flood like situations. So there will be improved storm drainage facilities so that the water can quickly drain away. Okay, you will have the utility conducts for conducting various, you know, the maintenance and certain things, and also you will have the underground ducts for electrical and you know other communication lines that can also be passed through. Okay, so that will have these added features that will make the road more smarter. Okay, obviously besides landscaping, the streetscaping, the provision of small street furniture, and creating and developing the basic convenience along the roads are also included in the scope of the work. That everything will make the road more smarter. Okay, more helpful in the basically to the pedestrians as well as for the commuters who basically use this road. Okay, then integrated command and the control center. So this integrated command and the control center, as you know, as the name suggests, that it is a basically a center which will be used as a single point of coordinated, you know, decision making center. It will be used as a single point coordinated decision making center, right, for various agencies. Okay, so the Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation stone of the integrated command and the control center at Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. So integrated command and the control center will be made, right, at Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Okay, and this project will be built at the cost of 94 crores rupees. Okay, and that integrated command and control center will have the smart solutions for the Thiruvananthapuram Municipal Corporations. Okay, and you know, that will be using, or that integrated command and control center will be used, right, as a common point, right, that can be used, right, during the emergency to facilitate a coordinated work. Because during emergency, for example, if a cyclone comes, earthquake comes, or any sort of a disaster occur, you need the better coordination between the different agencies. So interagency coordination, right, the center and the state coordination, so all sort of a coordination can be needed. So this center can be used as a common point of the coordination between the various agencies of center and the states. Okay, so this control room or the war room at integrated control command and the control center would act as a single point of coordinated action. Okay, and the decision making, you know, center between the various forces. For example, under this integrated command and control center, various stakeholders will be involved. For example, police, civic supplies, revenue officials, health officials, firefighting officials. Okay, so all such stakeholders are basically participate in this integrated command and control center that will have more coordinated approach, and that can basically boost, you know, the preparedness for any for tackling of any sort of a disaster related or any sort of emergency related situations in and around the Thiruvananthapuram in the Kerala. Okay, for that purpose, an integrated command and the control center will be constructed, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi will lay the foundation stone for this integrated command and control center. All right. Next, the Kasaragod solar power project. Okay, so this Kasaragod solar power project is again going to be constructed at, you know, Kerala. Okay, so Prime Minister Narendra Modi would dedicate to the nation this 50 megawatt of Kasaragod solar power project, which is already constructed in the Kerala. Okay, this project was constructed under the National Solar Energy Mission to produce the solar energy from the panels or from the solar panels, right? These solar panels are basically set up on the grounds, right, which can basically, you know, attract or which can basically, you know, snap the sun rays and convert into the electricity, and which is basically stored for the uses, right? So under Solar Energy Mission, the Kasargod solar project, solar power project was completed, right? And it will produce the 50 megawatt of energy, right? And this Kasargod solar power project is basically spread over 250 acres of the land, because you need to set up the solar panels also. These solar panels require the land to be set, okay? So this 250 acres of the land basically spread across the Paivalik, the Minja, and the Chipar villages of Kasargod district. So it is primarily located in the Kasargod district of Kerala, okay? And the central government basically gave, right, certain investment with respect to this building of this solar power project. So 280 crores have been given by the central government as an investment, right, for the building of the Kasargod solar power projects in the Kasargod district of Kerala. That will boost definitely the power in the Kasargod district of Kerala. Okay, next. The Pugalur-Thrissur water power transmission project. Okay, so Pugalur is basically in the Tamil Nadu and Thrissur is basically in the Kerala, right? So there is a power transmission from Tamil Nadu to Kerala. Okay, you might have seen the transmission cables, okay, the high voltage transmission cables. These transmission cables would ply or would run from, you know, Tamil Nadu to the Kerala. So that will connect the two states. Okay, so here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi again will inaugurate the 320 kilowatt the Pugalur Thrissur power transmission project, right? Okay, so it is basically, this project is basically the voltage source converter based high voltage direct current supply project. Okay, so it is basically the India's first high voltage direct current project link, which will be having the state of art, you know, the voltage source converter technology. So it is consisting of the state of art voltage source, you know, converter technology, and it is the first such high voltage direct current project, and it is the India's first such project which will be inaugurated by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. This project, or which is known as the Pugalur Thrissur project, is basically built at the cost of 5070 crore rupees. This project will facilitate to transfer about 2000 megawatt of power from the western region, right? And that will ultimately means from the Tamil Nadu region, and that will basically will be transferred to the Kerala region. That will help to meet the growth in the load for the people of Kerala. Okay, and this voltage source converter, right, based system is basically features integration of the high voltage direct current, you know, cross-linked polyurethane cables. These cables would be plying overhead lines, right? And that will basically, you know, saves the right of the way, as well as that will basically saves the amount of the land which will be used, right, for, you know, for making those poles which can basically hold those cables. So such, you know, the overhead cables will be taking around 35% to 40% less land, okay, for building of that, or for, you know, for basically plying of that cables. And that will definitely help in reduction of the footprint in terms of the uses of the land, right, as compared to the conventional high voltage direct current project that we basically, you have seen a cross like this type of structure, right? You have seen this type of structure. So the cables lines generally ply like that. Okay. And this is basically the high voltage transmission lines. So they basically ply in such a way. Okay. So such type of project will basically, you know, also take the land. For example, for construction, this one, you need the land. For construction, this one, you need the land. Okay. So obviously the voltage source converter system would take the lesser amount of land, because it will have the state of art, the voltage source converter technology, which is based on the high voltage direct current project. Okay, that will be a transmission line that will be open for transmission of the, you know, the 320 kV Palghur, you know, Thrissur transmission project, that will be basically transferring or around 2000 megawatt of the energy from the Pugalur in the Tamil Nadu to Thrissur in the Kerala region. And that will basically help in the certain set of developmental activities, especially those people who resides in the Kerala region. Okay, obviously. Okay, so that's all. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.